Hi, my name's Rob Collins. I'm the A&R and Marketing Director at Cooking Vinyl. I'd like to welcome our guests and our panel to the second of Cooking Vinyl's Future of Sessions, where we examine issues that are kind of affecting all of us working in the music business today. Tonight, our focus is on fan engagement and how we can get better and connect better with fans to enhance and develop our kind of relationships for all parties, for both sides of the equation. As you all know, relationships with fans are becoming more and more complex, and with so many distractions in people's lives and so little attention, how do we get our messages heard and importantly, to stick? So that's really the gist of what we're kind of discussing tonight. So I'd like to hand you over to Tim Ingham, our moderator, who will guide us through tonight's choppy waters. Thanks, Tim.
Cheers, Rob. Some quick fire questions coming your way. We've obviously got quite a few panellists, so as we move along, I'm going to kind of eke out what the people here do and what their relationship to the whole idea of an artist and a fan connecting is. I'd like to start with Dave, if that's okay. Dave, as a manager, what elements of the artist-fan relationship have you seen become less important, and which have you seen become more important over the past few years?
Well, sadly, buying records seems to have become less important to most fans. I think probably the relationship, certainly in the pop world, between products, not just endorsed products, but manufactured products, in the artist's name and the art, I think that's definitely become a lot more of a big thing for fans. We just launched a 22-piece clothing range with Charlie XCX, which sold out in like a week with Boohoo. We've bizarrely just done a body spray with Asda, which is doing 50,000 cans a month right now. You know, and needless to say, her album didn't sell 50,000 copies a month. So it's sort of, I think people are interested in the person, and then what the person, and they buy into a person, and then they buy into anything relevant from that person.
And how does the artist feel about that? I mean, not only in Charlie XCX's case, but with the other artists you work with, they must be starting to stumble across this realisation that their record isn't the be-all and end-all. It certainly doesn't just stop at tickets. It's more than that, as you say. It's their whole brand, if you like. How do they feel about the fact that their music might not be the most important part to some people?
Well, I think the music's the catalyst. You know, I think that's the important thing that people don't. Get confused. The music is still the most important thing. It just doesn't come in the format that we would hope that it would do. The music is the first thing they buy into. But you know, I think they're pretty relaxed about it. And I think actually, there's actually probably more money to be made out of doing what we're doing now than what there was before. To be really honest. I seem to run into lots of people who seem to be utterly depressed about the whole thing, and we seem to be finding that it's actually really good, and I don't really understand the misery. I mean, maybe from Robert Martin's position as a record company,
it's quite difficult,
but from our position, it's not really that difficult. You know, you take something like the Libertines, for example, which whereas before you were having to, you know, really look at every penny. The Libertines, Dior did an entire season's clothing on the Libertines, and they got a pair of free trousers and some shoes. Now we have our own clothing range with Savile Row, you know, and that seems to make a lot more money than the shoes.
Lucy, what Dave's discussing there is something that Marillion have had experience of for a long time, which I guess is not necessarily playing the mainstream game, not doing the traditional, we've got to get on mainstream radio, we've got to get mainstream media interested, but maximising a fan base who are really interested in the act. Can you talk us through how you came across this realisation to start with? When was the moment that Marillion really started to push that envelope?
Well, let me start by saying we wanted to get on mainstream radio, we wanted to get in mainstream media, but Marillion, even in the 80s, you know, when they were playing Milton Keynes Bowl, people weren't interested. So sort of from the 80s, really, the band really started formulating a very close relationship with their fans. Once that sort of, you know, once the band, you know, it's well documented, you know, Mark Kelly realised the internet was going to be huge before anybody else did, you know, and in the music business. And in 1994, Marillion registered marillion.com. And it was always very important to the band to forge a relationship and to say, look, come to us, stay with us, and we'll reward you. So we do things like, you know, we do things like, you know, buy the new album, buy this new DVD we're doing from us, we'll enter you into a prize draw, and you can win a chance to be in the next Marillion video, for example. And Marillion have been doing this for, you know, 20 years. I've been managing them for 15 years. And it's just always been so important to us. I realise we're different from your acts, because no one would sponsor us or any of that kind of stuff, or give us a clothing line. Sorry, that would be a really funny clothing line. Sorry, that's really just amused me. So we have to find different ways of doing, you know, that, and just keep the fans, you know, they're the customer, and they are always right, even if they're arseholes, sometimes they are.
I wanted to move over this side of the panel and just ask about the idea that recorded music is becoming the least important element of an artist's campaign. Rob, if I come to you first, is that something that concerns you, that artists might be looking at body sprays or suits or certainly tickets before they're looking at the recorded music?
Obviously, the downturn in income is a problem for us, but we have to come up with kind of clever, innovative ways of looking at refinancing products, coming up with special packaging, deluxe packaging, working with people like Bruce and working with people like Paul from Pledge to try and monetize the assets, I suppose, in the most lucrative way to fund the project. And sometimes there isn't enough money to fund the whole project, so you have to look elsewhere. Maybe you have to look for funding elsewhere, or maybe you have to jointly fund part of the project with the artist who's got the clothing range, who's got the money, who needs the record to go on tour. And it becomes much more of a holistic 360 view of putting a record out and working within the ecosystem of the artist.
And is it still the case? One thing that interests me about the idea of hitting the same fans or hitting a targeted fan base is, do you not need to still go down the traditional routes and woo the traditional gatekeepers to get there? Do you not need to get those artists on radio or in the mainstream media?
You do if you can, but you don't have to rely on it 100% to have a successful record. You know, if you can talk to the fans in the right way, and especially if the artist can be really engaging, because I think that's where you get found out. If it's a dry record company message coming all the time, they're like, this is rubbish, I'm just being sold here. In, you know, taking one of Dave's artists, John McClure from Revenant and the Makers, he's genius. He sells his stuff so well. And if you could bottle him and sell him to
every artist, bottled him and sold him.
Oh, you have, actually, haven't you?
Yeah.
Is that the spray?
You
know,
no, beer.
You know, if you could bottle the essence of John McClure and give a little bit of that to every artist, I think they'd all do better.
Bruce, can you first and foremost give us a little précis of what it is Townsend does and the artists you work with, but also wanted to get your view on the idea of new and breaking artists and how you fit into that world. Is it only acts with an established or heritage fan base that work well for you, or can you work for new and up and coming artists?
We'll work with anybody. You know, I mean, we're music first and foremost. We're music fans. We love music. But obviously, we're an independent company. We're funded on profit, not investment. So we have to keep an eye on that bottom line and make sure we can run a profitable business that allows us to work within music and not be diluted by selling TVs or pots and pans, which some people come to us to do because we're a good fulfillment company. Townsend Music is an independent music retailer, distribution services company. We set up 35 years ago with some independent records shops. We still have our independent record shops, which we're very proud about. We went online with our website in 1998. I believe we were the first independent music website to become chart eligible. And over the last 20 years, we've just invested all our revenues and in development. We've built, we feel that we're one of the leading D2C companies. So we build artist shops and we sell everything artist related. We sell tickets, albums, downloads, merchandise, subscriptions, anything that an artist wants to sell. So as a result of that, we work with pretty much all the labels, majors and independents out there. And we are primarily brought in to maximise an artist's chart position. So we sit down with artists and managers 4 or 5 months ahead of the release and plan the strategy. So as a result of that, we meet the labels, the managers, the promoters, everybody a part of it, really. Yes, we've got hundreds of well-established international artists that have a big fan base that we sell lots of records, tickets and merch for, like Noel Gallagher, the Pixies, the Prodigy. But we've been working with the Cortinas for quite some time, who I think it's fair to say wouldn't walk on a Radio 1 playlist. And it's a very, very independent setup. And they just get the idea of getting the price right. Even now, they'll sell things at an attractive price to the fans, because they realise they're that type of band. They're a band of the people, where we wouldn't do an £80 box set, because the fans will buy the album for £10 and a T-shirt for £20, and they'll always do that. You know, part of what is crucial, you have to engage your fans to get a fan base, and then you've got to make sure you keep hold of them. You know, the business has changed now, whereby you can't just tour every 2 years and release a standard dual case CD with a 4-page booklet and expect to get £10 for it. You know, you have to concentrate on providing exclusive content and great service, so the fans feel we'll always come back to you. You know,
and that's probably an element of a constant conversation between artists and fans. Paul, how does Pledge fit into this? How do you help an artist have that conversation? And what pitfalls would you say there are for artists trying to have that conversation?
Well, I think the worst thing an artist can do to their fan base is just continuously sell. I think picking up on a lot of what Dave and Lucy said and Bruce said, fans also want to feel rewarded, they want to feel part of the overall story. So I think the worst thing an artist can do is just always beat that hard sell through their own social media, through their own stores, whether it's a Pledge Music store, whether it's a Townsend store. So I think they have to find the right balance of rewarding them, selling to them, but also the right balance of not talking to them. Because you don't want to sell your soul, do you know what I mean? You don't want to be ramming yourself down your fans' throats every day, all day. We have to try and maintain a little bit of mystique, slightly. It's difficult because of today's social media and because of what fans demand. Fans are very quick now. You know, it's either a one track and I'm off, or it's a one purchase or I'm off. So I think you do have to keep your fan engaged, but you have to find the right balance for the type of artist that you are, you know. And so I think just be wary always of, like I say, the hard sell. You know, you have to find a nice subtle and nice balanced way of treating your fans.
And what have you learned on Pledge to help the closeness between artist and fan, and how do you think that's going to impact on all elements of the music business as we move on?
I think one of the things we've seen work really well is that it's actually not reinventing the wheel in any sense, but it's content. It's value for money and it's content. So whatever you're offering the fan to purchase, you know, make sure it's of value, really. And sometimes that can be of a low-end value, but fans do actually want to buy stuff, right? They do. The highest-selling item across all our stores is the signed CD. And then you move up to the signed vinyl. And then you move up to the signed deluxe edition, if there is. But fans also want to be part of some form of experience or, you know, or engagement. So whether that's On the crowdfunding side of what we do, whether that's studio visits or, you know, dare I even say house gigs, etc., etc., fans do want these things, and they've almost become a little bit of the norm now, between whether that's a crowdfunding campaign or a pre-order campaign. So offer the fans value for money. Offer them, you know, ask your fans what you want. I think when we, before we started Marillion, we surveyed the fans a little bit through social media as to what they would like to buy, you know, and fans will buy it. And then content, you know, it's, again, it's not reinventing the wheel, but good exclusive content for people who have bought items or have been a part of your campaign, so they maybe get something that a little bit special. And then for the wider consumer who may or may not want to come and purchase something, make sure you've got the right sort of content just to bring them in, really.
Yeah, speaking of content, Sarah, you work for a ticketing company. And traditionally, of course, ticketing company has been a pretty basic kind of retailer, I would suggest. How are you now adding to the idea of being able to monetize fans and getting the best value for an artist out of a fan?
Well, yeah, I mean, I suppose generally we're seen as kind of like having the ideals of the promoter or the venue in mind when we're selling tickets, but we actually have a dedicated team at Ticketmaster that's been around for a few years now, but not many people are aware of it. It's called the Artist Services Team, and their job is purely to look after artists, managers, labels, and kind of what their interests are. So their interest might not be in selling a ticket, their interest might be generating record sales. So, for instance, we work with a lot of partners on kind of pre-sale stuff. So you sign up for, you know, buy the album, get access to a pre-sale. During the ticket process, we can add any kind of upsell on there, whether that be merchandise, box sets, whatever you want. So we can generate, or even looking into the other side of stuff, is generating data. So we have access to 13 million customers at Ticketmaster, and we can use the kind of data insights team that we've got, which is a whole floor. And kind of some of the tools that we've got, like one is called the Affinity Tool, which basically, using the data that we've got, lets us look at customers' purchase habits. So if they've bought for one artist, they've got more likelihood to buy for another artist, or if they've bought a rugby ticket, there's more likelihood they're going to buy for a certain artist. And we can use that data to target data capture campaigns, upsells on merchandise and all that kind of stuff. So there's an actual team there that looks after those interests.
I'm going to come to Martin in a second because it might get slightly complex when we do that. So I'll leave this to Sarah for a second. Dave, how do you feel about relying on third parties, be it Ticketmaster or Spotify, or social media networks to get your data about your artists?
Well, we don't just do that anyway. There's an awful lot of people we mine data from anyway. Some people are just good at doing certain things, you know. I mean, and it's different from act to act as well. You know, we work with Paul, for example, on a pledge on Killing Joke. Killing Joke don't speak to their audience at all. Like, I mean, three of them don't even own phones or computers, so there's no ability to do that. So you sort of have to become the voice of the act with Paul. And actually, I think and it's not just old acts, I know that's the truth, but just what's helped me from working with Pledge, for example, is I actually think we've made the man bigger through how we communicate through the D2C and what we sell. Because he's right, the people do want it, but what they want is good stuff. I don't even think the price point matters with a lot of bands. I think as long as it's really good and it feels worth the money, then they want it. And certainly, and you could argue this is for a lot of reasons, but since we've been engaging with the fans on these special things, including £300 box sets and blah, gosh knows whatever else, our ticket sales have gone up. Our album, our actual studio album sales are bigger than they ever be. We're in our third highest chart position ever, I think.
Yep.
Number 16. In the UK charts this time around. So actually, in some cases, I think that engagement and that selling thing, if it's done in the right way, it's actually helping the overall career.
I think it does create a galvanisation of the fans, though. I think, you know, a really well-run pre-order or crowdfunding campaign, in a sense, like Dave said, doesn't have to have the artist actually talking to the fans, but just a very well run, you know, well executed, great products, price point doesn't matter for certain artists, will then have a knock-on effect to other areas of the artist's career, rather than just sort of campaign of one album, but it'll be the career, really, because the fans will stay with you because they had good service once before.
What's interesting about the Ticketmaster type thing as well is that I remember a few years ago, even with the startups, even things like Songkick, where you talked to Ian and whatever, when I'd ask them about helping us sell albums, they'd laugh, literally laugh. They'd be like, you're just in the past, no one cares, and we're not doing that anymore. And it was always like that. And I think when John Reed went into Ticketmaster And certain changes in the way that people consume lots of vinyl and whatnot, I think has forced everybody to reconsider that. And certainly when I saw Ian recently from Songkick, he was like, you know what, you were absolutely right about that. We should have been taking that a lot more seriously. And these guys definitely do now, you know, really do.
Yeah, we had like one of our best months a couple of months ago on album sales, on the, some of the pre-sales and pre-orders that we did. So we're just seeing growth continually, definitely.
So as a ticketing company, you judge yourself slightly on how many albums you sell?
No, but it's nice to see that. We do have a chart, we do have an album chart now that goes around every week. So before, no, we probably didn't, no one within the business probably cared how many albums we sell. But when you're selling like 3,000 for an artist during a pre-sale, people suddenly stand up and take notice. So
what's really unhelpful is the way that the industry as a whole reacts to when you're trying to do these kind of bundling of things. We're constantly hampered by doing things by stupid rules that are archaic and go back to a time where people were trying to buy records into the charts. It's like, you know, we're almost trying to find out ways to get people to pay for something they don't want anymore. Mm. You know, so there's no point in keeping insisting on different rules. It's almost like people try and catch you out all the time. We did the first ever download with a ticket, which we charted The Enemy at number 7, I think, in the UK charts off the back of that. And they took great delight in closing it down.
Mm. The official charts,
yeah.
Can't they?
And it's like, well, why are you doing that? The Foo Fighters got one through, I think, just after us, and then they closed down. It's just so irritating.
And they're constantly changing as well, I think. I think that's the thing. Like, you get one thing passed for one artist, and then the next week you try it again,
totally.
and it's
yeah,
completely
it's
changed. So some kind of clarification on how it all works. And especially, you know, we're saying about the OCC and getting that kind of registration stuff. It's a long, lengthy process as well, and it's not welcoming to new people becoming on board. So
it's like they're in the 80s and we're in 2015, and it's just completely maddening. And you're right, the speed at which they try and change things round is just, how are you supposed to actually get some kind of focus and flow in how you do this if they just keep stopping it all? Mm. It's like they're on the wrong side, and they're not supposed to be a body that governs what we do. They're supposed to be a body that helps us, in my opinion.
No, I agree. Definitely.
Do you feel slightly ostracised by the pair of you, really, by chart rules that perhaps want to see certain types of acts in the top 10?
Well, yeah. I mean, we wanted to do something with the Pledge Music campaign that we're doing. One of the reasons we've gone with Pledge Music is that our Marillion.com shop isn't chart eligible, and we wanted to try for the chart, so we decided to go with Pledge Music because they're chart eligible, as I said, one of the reasons. And as we always give something to our fans that pre-order our album for us for, you know, a year before we've even made it. We always give them something. We always say, you know, buy the album now and we will put you in a draw to play on the album, be in a video, all of these things. And we Pledge Music contacted, you know, the charts company, and they said, oh, we can't do that.
Yeah, we had it the same.
And it's a thank you.
And if it was Metallica or U2 or something, then maybe I'd understand it a little bit more. But it's not. It's people that depend on it. You know, like Reverend the Maker is something that I work on with Rob and with Paul. You know, all we wanted to do this time around was have a thing that if you could prove you bought the album, that he might go around your house and show a film, play a gig, all that kind of thing. But no, that's too much. Mm. But it isn't too much.
Yeah, they said it was too much, and that's just stupid, because they said it would incentivise someone to buy the album. Or we were like, no, it wouldn't.
That's what we're trying to do, isn't it? We want to incentivise people to buy the album.
But also, that's exactly right. Yeah. In this instance, we knew a certain amount of people would pre-order in the first week, and it was like, let's do this to say thank you. Thank you.
Sure.
It's not an incentive. Anything that was happening now, because it's the pre-order's been running for 3 months, anything happening now would be an incentive, and the charts would, you know, I understand that, but not at the beginning. It was a thank you. And
you've got to ask yourself how you've got into the situation where the only thing that you can't monetize from a fan base is the album. Mm. I mean, that's just insane.
Mm. To play devil's advocate, I would ask why you, as a progressive manager, are still judging yourselves on album sales and chart position.
I don't at all. In fact, I took the column of earnings out of the spreadsheet 7 years ago that had anything of that on it. But
you took the column of earnings from album sales out of your spreadsheet
7 years ago, yeah. Because there was no point in as far as I was concerned, until streaming became what I know it's going to be, and I stand by that wholeheartedly. we're all looking down the back of the couch. And there's no point in having an office full of people that don't understand that that's what it is. There was an assumption that you know, that something would come along and save us, and it has, but it's just not here. Yeah.
With us, going back to what you were saying, we haven't tried to have a chart position since, you know, for like 10 years or whatever. For the last four albums, we haven't bothered. And this time we thought, well, let's give it a go, see what happens. We may chart, we may not, because the mainstream media that we all crave and we've been craving since the 80s, just might, they might not, but they might pay attention if you're in the top 10 or something. So that's why we did it. But for us, record sales still really are important. And yes, they are decreasing, but the fans still want, you know, the fans will buy the album physically and listen to it on Spotify. So we're getting two lots of money. So to us, it is still important, but we're different from, you know. So
I think I said something stupid then. It is important to me, but it's one of 10 things that's important to me now, rather than the important thing.
Oh, yeah,
it's also the thing the whole industry looks at. So of course you would want to be in it to win it. But
well, they shouldn't. They should think it's a load of old nonsense. But I take it that they.
Yeah, it's nonsense. But you know, it doesn't matter if we don't. If we do, what a laugh.
And day on date and streaming anyway is now going to completely destroy any credibility that it had anyway. So
I think it's fair to say that what you guys are asking to be eligible is marketing ideas, because not everybody's signed to a major label that can benefit from £500,000 worth of TV advertising after X Factor. So if we were artists that don't have that marketing resources, then all you're being is being proactive marketeers. To get the album in front of people that wouldn't normally see it.
It's about bringing value back to the album, isn't it? Which is what the industry is supposed to do, isn't it? Bring value back to the music. So if you can open it up to having John turn up at your house, you know, play a show, if that's what you want, or other rewards, then that is bringing value back to music. That will create more album sales. So the album is the catalyst for absolutely everything else you're talking about, whether it's perfume ranges or not. Therefore, the industry should allow us to bring value back to music.
Yeah, I agree.
Martin, we can't make the most of monetizing a fan base. We don't know who they are, what they're willing to spend, and what their behaviour is. You briefly, if possible, you explained it to me, and I hope I've got this right, that you help brands track and reward consumers online. What mistakes is the music industry making at the minute to not maximise their ability to do just that?
They've relied on technology companies too much. So they basically surrendered all of their rights and their ability to market to technology businesses who are run by venture capitalists. So, you know, Spotify's going to do their 11 billion IPO, and that's great because there'll be record companies make more money on the shares than they will on selling records. So you have to ask yourself where the value lies, and it lies with the musician and the fan. And the fan is actually largely what we do. So we think that's the centre of the business. So understanding them, what's authentic, and then tracking all value to them and their network is, I think, the key. I heard a lot, it was a fascinating panel already, but I mean, the first thing is somebody saying, don't you want your own data? Why would you surrender it to companies like Facebook, for example, or Twitter? Because they are not charities. They're businesses run for profits by shareholders. So try and get organic search. Actually, it's going down every year on Facebook. So what looked great isn't great because of the purposes technology has put. It's not technology that's the problem. It's just that I think that technology should be owned by the artists and the fans as a tool.
So what can artists do? I mean, Marillion own their own store. What's the next step to take control of that?
Give the tools to the, well, so you give tools to the super fans who have a network of people around them, on average 200. So that represents a distribution network, and you can track that and return value back. So you can turn value back in surprising ways. Somebody who comes off a video with a tracking link goes to a merchant in the affiliate networks, and, you know, on average we'll make about £8-10 a purchase, and we pay half back to the artist. So that's very tangible. And that's income that they don't have. Effectively, it's paying artists for influence, not products. I think that's the key difference, is we're in a product universe, and in the cusp of change, And it's swapping around very quickly to direct consumer, peer-to-peer, with no intermediaries. And I think that will be great for artists because, you know, we all know, you know, Velvet Underground, 500,000 records, but who wasn't influenced by them if you're in a band?
Rob, are you at all worried that we're becoming over-reliant, or you as a company becoming over-reliant on these third parties, Facebook, Twitter, Spotify, etc., rather than owning the conversation yourself?
I think all these companies, you know, they have communities, and people love going on Spotify. They might not like being on Apple Music, and so on and so on. So you have to work with these companies to get to those people. If they're great fans, you probably pick them up along the way somehow anyway, either through your sharing data with the ticketing people or sharing data with people like Bruce. You know, it's our data, it's the band's data when we work with Bruce and when we work with Paul. We're not giving the data away.
Yeah, but Paul, that's something Pledge is particularly proud of, right? That you give the maximum extent of data back to them.
Yeah, every single bit, so every postcode, every email address belongs to the band. Yeah, we don't hold on to any of it unless they opt in.
Yeah, and we also try to build our own pools of data from the artist's websites. You know, we can put a cookie on there, we can track that IP address and where it goes on the site, what sort of purchase it makes, how much money it makes, grade them or segment them into Uber fans, or they've bought a ticket, they've bought a t-shirt. And we can share that data back. It's not our data. We're happy to share it with Dave, you know, if Dave wants it, or anyone involved in your campaign can use it. So we're not over-reliant on these big technology companies land grabbing all the data, but we would like them to share a little bit more sometimes.
Anyone working with our artist services team as well, that's what it's all about. It's all about generating that data. So, you know, say for instance we were running a data capture campaign for a festival or an artist or a pre-sale or something like that. You know, you generate all that data, even if only 50% of those people convert into buying a ticket, the artist or the manager still get that other 50% to communicate with. So, you know, we're all up for sharing data. It's not something that we keep to ourselves.
I just want to point something out. Strictly speaking, the artist doesn't own the data, the fan does, under Data Protection Act. So if you're keeping it, watch out for the ombudsman.
No, sure, but you put your little...
You put your striking
up,
on.
Don't you? So
I guess my point is, when you start to change the equation and you see that the fans can help you distribute, if you understand how much of a fan they are, which is subtle, it's authentic, what's authentic, that's something Paul said that I think is right, then actually you want the super fans. And, you know, I started off, you know, in, you know, indie rock and roll and dance music, and what mattered to us was whether a record went in a record mirror, and it was almost a science for us, you know. So I grew up doing that stuff. And the same at B&G, would take that, exactly the same.
I guess
cards, you know, nothing new.
With the panel being the future of the difficulty is anticipating how big a fan someone is, rather than just relying on what they spend, what they might be willing to spend.
Right.
Needs to be really
tough. So really then, the trick, if you want to understand what's happening, is what a fan is doing to another fan, because that's where demand really starts, off the page, somewhere else. And if you can understand that, you only need two fans and a good song to start to have it work.
So they become ambassadors for the artists.
Yeah, you've got 2.5 billion people with smartphones and common operating systems.
That's
so
where
there's
like
a huge distribution network.
Sorry, that's where an affiliate system works really well with us, whereas we can put album widgets anywhere on the internet.
Yeah.
Fans can use those, and then they have a login to, they can see how much traffic their widget has generated. Everything's fully transparent, and that's great for the artist and management to have that data.
So does the fan get a small kickback for being an affiliate?
Yes, because, you know, if they run a fan website or a fan Facebook and they have a lot of traffic, not every band's official social media or website is as popular as the unofficial ones.
Yeah.
So if they are driving traffic and album sales, then we feel it's appropriate to assign them an affiliate payment.
And do you think that's something that will grow as a trend in future as far as these sort of armies continue to...
Yeah, I think so, because you see things about, you know, like people doing chart positions of fans and how popular their sites are and traffics are and things, and people get incentivized by being seen to be doing great work for a band that they love, you know.
How do you feel about this trend, Dave? paying fans for advocating your artists to each other so that a purchase is made?
I just think whatever works, works. I just don't really care about any of it. It's just like if something comes along that works, I'll use it. Facebook to me is stopping working now. I think the algorithm's been over tinkered with, and you're in a position whereby I think a band like Kill and Joke probably benefits from it way more than an artist like Charlie, whose fans have long since realised their gran and their uncles and their mum and dad are on the platform. I think Spotify and Apple Music are gonna change things. Spotify, unlike Apple, is pretty much owned by the record businesses largely, or at least partially. If you think about how Apple, it's an important relationship, is that Apple have never really cared about the content, they care about selling machinery. And it's kind of like what the record business was right at the very beginning, where you had a Philips record player, or maybe I'm making that up, or an RCA record player, or whatever else. They were never bothered about selling records, that's why they were never centrally distributed. They were sold at rock and rock, at county fairs. No one cared about the content, they cared about the hardware. And that's what Apple took us back to, a singles market that was really, I mean, if you look at the platform to this day, it looks like an ugly platform. Even Spotify's platforms are ugly, actually. But no, I don't care. But Spotify, being owned by the labels, is going to change things. And I've seen what's coming next with Apple Music as well, and that's going to be far more of a manager stroke band stroke label to directly to the consumer. From what I can understand, it's going to be a little bit like MySpace. Every person's page on Apple Music is going to be a little bit like that as it goes out. So I think the technology companies are understanding that relationship directly has to be given back to them. And I think Spotify will have to follow suit.
And let's move on to streaming particularly. The downside is that per listen, per track, the money coming in is micro pennies. But the I guess one big upside that people have talked about is that it's a great promotional platform as well as the revenue that comes in, a great promotional platform for sales and merchandise and ticketing. Is it working for you and your artists? A direct link from Spotify, for instance, to Songkick or a merchandising site, are you seeing any significant revenues from that?
No. But what I would say, and I know I'm deeply unfashionable about these, I think that streaming is going to make the music industry richer than anything it's ever known before. I think the sheer level of money that's going to pour into this industry in the next 5 to 7 years is going to be extraordinary. And I think it's what ends up being done with that and what ends up being and how we all react to it. I've seen all the plans for how it's going to be built into everybody's everyday life. You know, the price to the consumer is going to be almost unnoticeable, and actually probably will be unnoticeable in most bits. It'll be hidden in phone bills, in car purchases, in radio, physical radios, and whatever else. And it's going to be an extraordinary change about, I think. So I haven't noticed that, and obviously there's not much money coming in from it yet. But if you look at it on a graph, it's like that, and not much else in the music industry is.
Yeah, I mean, it's difficult. Spotify, you can allegedly, sell some merchandise and things through it, but actually getting it set up is just so time-consuming and so difficult that we sort of, I think we put one thing on there and then just gave up. So it's like all these things, they make it really complicated, and if they made it easier for artists and managers and record companies, whoever, they would, you know, everyone would sell more, everyone would do it, but they just make it really difficult.
Because it's not their primary function, that's why. Yeah. Mm. And I think that you guys are actually getting better at it. Yeah. But even though it's definitely not your primary function, you are definitely getting better at it.
I was going to say, Sarah, you're not a spokesperson for Ticketmaster worldwide, so no one takes that out of context, but it's an interesting question that, do you think the streaming services are doing enough to work with, I know Spotify have teamed up with Songkick, and that's not you, but are they doing enough generally to work with ticketing companies?
Yeah, I mean, we're starting to come into the conversation at the moment. I mean, again, I'm not a spokesperson for Ticketmaster Worldwide. All the decisions are not made on my head, but there's a lot. We're getting a lot stronger in working with partners. It's something that we've kind of been a bit closed off with in the past few years, and we're getting much more open. So, you know, working with these guys a lot closer, and, you know, streaming companies will come into it. The I don't think the Songkick relationship's exclusive, but with Spotify, but we'll see. But, you know, there's lots of...
They're owned by the same person, aren't they, really? They're owned by Len Blavetnik.
You know, you can always try, though, can't you, get in there? But, yeah, we're working a lot more on partnerships and how we work with other companies to be able to do that. We're really good at selling tickets. That's what we do. Everyone else is really good at doing what they're doing. How can we all work together to make sure that, you know, we're engaging the fan at the right point, that it's a lot easier for people to do this. You know, the technology that we've all got at our fingertips at the moment with, you know, all the feeds and all that kind of stuff, it should be easy to do these kind of things. And I think that because we're all kind of a little bit trying to keep hold of our part of the world, that that's what makes it a little bit tricky. So working on those relationships is a big part of what I do now.
One thing that is, I suppose, a danger of concentrating on maximising the revenue per head of an existing audience is, how do you ever grow that audience? If you're kind of resigned to thinking, we're not going to play the mainstream game, we've got our audience and we're just going to overserve them and overserve the superfan, are they not inevitably going to dwindle, Paul?
Hopefully not, no, because I think when you sort of, well, in terms of the case of Players Music, we've sort of managed to build up our own community of, I guess, consumers, I would call them music consumers, which is now over 1 million worldwide, which is pretty decent. And I think for us, when we work with an artist, which is one of the ways we've managed to start working with emerging artists now, as well as old established rock bands, not that Killing Joke are really old established rock bands, but I mean that.
Certainly established.
Yeah, established. Is that we sort of actively market towards our community. So we're trying to drive new artists, emerging artists, but also just the artists that we're working with, whatever genre, into our community and sort of hopefully build up new data for those bands that we're working with. We're sort of seeing stats across the board that 30 to 40% of the business generated on campaigns is coming from within our community. So there's definitely working, there's definitely a connection. And I think when we surveyed our community, the feedback was fascinating in that they're not interested in digital via Pledge Music whatsoever. You know, the answer was, if I'm going to go digital, I'll go to Spotify or iTunes, that's my preferred. But that, I want the signed CD, I want the signed vinyl, I want the screen print. So we're a community of collectors, really. So the more acts we work with, the more people that opt in to Pledge Music to be part of our community, the more hopefully we can grow data for artists. And it is a case that we do campaigns now purely for data. You know, the artist doesn't need money, so they're not crowdfunding, and the pre-order, they don't even really need to do that so much because they'll sell well at retail anyway, but they come to us to try and generate new data to sort of move forward.
To improve their data, to sell more tickets,
all that,
increase their income.
And that's what's important, isn't it? It's finding out and digging down exactly what the artist wants, and I think that's what you've got to make clear when you're starting to discuss these campaigns, is what do you want to get out of it? Do you want to sell tickets? Is that your main aim, or is that the promoters? You know, what do you want from it? And then working with them to deliver
it. I think there's an interesting point about, one thing we've got to do is just make it easy for the fan, right? Stop making it so complicated. So the more we can work together, you know, the more everybody can work together, the better. So we're not experts in ticketing whatsoever, never have been, probably never will be. So we've integrated with Ticketmaster and we've integrated with C-Tickets to help us in that respect. So now it's easier for the fan, it's better for the fan.
See, I think, you know, echoing what Dave said, I think everyone just going forward, you know, just has to be able to work together. Whether it's, but what a lot of the companies need to do, you know, companies like Amazon, whoever, they need to be able to talk to the people like Marillion who are doing it on their own, like the up-and-coming bands who are doing it on their own, who either can't get a label or don't want a label. It can't just be like the old days that they're only talking to the major record companies and the ticket masters. And, you know, they need to be able to, all these companies need to talk to the smaller people too, whether that's a fan or whether that's an artist, you know, to make it easier for everyone. Throw everything and a little bit of everything, as Dave said, whatever works, whatever sells albums, tickets, T-shirts.
I mean, this is all the ecosystem. So if the ecosystem is Spotify, Pledge, you know, Apple Music, then all of that has to revert to the fan who wants to pick the artist they want. That's the right equation. You guys are pioneers of Kickstarter, basically. You started the whole thing off. I remember it. And now I think we're at a perfect moment. I think Dave said it. I think really music is artist currency. So they should be paid for that. That value should be translated back to them and the fans. And when you start to take away the complications in a network, everyone does better. So the trick, at least in engineering, is to make sure you reduce the signal to the noise. And if the signal is the music, how big can that get? And I think it's our job to make sure it keeps rolling, isn't it?
I think people have made mistakes in their communication strategy as well. It's all very tempting for an artist to do a deal with a clothing company, for example, for a line. But if their fans can't afford the line, and you'd be amazed how many people make that mistake. You know, I'm not saying this is true, by the way, but you're Beyonce, and because you're Beyonce, you think your fashion line should go through Prada. Well, the majority of your fans can't afford Prada, and more importantly, Prada don't really want to stock you, to be honest. And when we did the deal with Boohoo, which was for 22 pieces across the whole thing.
That's Charlie XCX.
Yeah, with Charlie. We realised that, first and foremost, that the product was affordable. It was completely affordable to exactly the age and the product and the consumer demographic that our fan base were in. That was the number one thing that made us go with that company, because it was completely relevant for a fan base, and price-wise as well. The second thing was, and this filters into... Maybe not. Yeah, it does do this. The second thing was, we realised that Boohoo's adverts were the most Shazammed adverts in Europe. So
how did you realise that?
Because they published that data.
They published
it.
Okay.
So when you realise that, and you see that Shazam genuinely is a metric that people pay attention to, for example, with any brand deal I've done over the last 5 years, and this is true, not one brand has asked us where we've charted with an act. All they look at is the online demographics and how you focus on Shazam, and to a lesser extent Spotify. So with that in mind, and understanding that we could write into the deal free songs on free adverts over 9 months, when we're going for a new album, and this is about how you get something above the parapets with this, I know my Shazam figure is going to be good going into the marketplace on the back of making my fans happy. Does that make sense?
Yeah, absolutely. I think raising Shazam is a whole other kettle of fish as well. That seems to be a way that the industry, certainly people in your position, Dave, are judging an artist's popularity. But should there be more of a direct monetary reward for that popularity? Is it, again, that's another third party who you're reliant upon, who's using data that's driven by music?
They do try and help, actually, Shazam. And Julian Marshall over here is very good at that kind of thing. But there's only so much they can do, because they're a very odd site, in as much as they found a purpose after they existed.
Yeah.
And because of that, sometimes I get the impression they don't really know what they are themselves. So they sort of come in and say, how can we help? And I go, well, you tell me. And they go, don't really know. And that's that. But on that, I mean, I've got a guy at the moment who's number 26 in Shazam after going on an advert on Monday. So the advert starts on Monday and today, and he's unknown. He's 26 on Shazam today, number one on Spotify viral. And that enough now, I shouldn't say this in this room probably, but it seems like, let's just say, that would be enough to then go to radio with, which is a bizarre concept, isn't it? You're on an ITV advert, you're no one at all. By Monday, you're no one. By Wednesday, you're someone, and by Friday, you're at radio. Mm. Isn't that weird?
I thought record companies were supposed to break artists.
I think they're funded.
No comment.
Well, no, because I don't think that's fair as well. People always say to me, oh, the record company's dead, but they're not. You know, it's like, the global network of marketing alone is worth having. And sometimes, you know, the arguments that Rob and I have, which I completely understand from his point of view, I just don't happen to share his view on it, is that you market to, and this is kind of what you were talking about, you know, what's the point in spending money on advertising? What's the point in spending money on radio when you've got 100,000 people on Facebook and you can just talk directly to them? And I'm not sure I agree with that.
Because you can't get to
especially because there's only one... less than 1% response rate. So
sure.
Jesus.
Unless you pay for it.
There's
so much wasted.
I mean, we make all our money as a record label on sync rights. So, you know, all the acts I've signed, we always break them first on ads, on social media, then ads, and that's when the majority of the income comes. And that's purely influence, because if you're a music supervisor, you're after the hottest thing first. That's got nothing to do with record sales. It's to do what the supervisor thinks of your act and what they think the advertiser will think you're at.
Which is utterly democratic. And that's the fascinating thing about where we're going with that, because I agree with Martin on that point, that I sold 27 million singles with Charlie last year, and every one of them was started off an advert. Every one of them. And now it appears this year it's going to be the same thing again. It's an oddity because it's completely democratic. In as much as the advertisers don't really care how young and cool you are, you could be 40 if you made the right song for the advert, which is really interesting. But also, what's really interesting is that the consumer has stopped caring about, in general, has stopped caring about what's cool. It's the middle-aged gatekeepers that now care about what's cool. It's like you have this conversation about how to get something to the people that don't care. Do you understand what I mean?
Yeah.
It's like one middle-aged guy is talking about a child to another middle-aged guy who then presents it to people who don't care. It's totally bizarre.
I don't know which radio station you could be talking about.
Look, I've got loads of things on the radio on BBC playlist right now, so I've got no problem with it whatsoever. I just feel I should point that out. But I'm saying it just seems like an odd thing that, you know, and this is really, I'm going to really struggle to not fall over my words here, but it's important, so I'm going to try and say it anyway. You know, Ed Sheeran is not a traditional looking pop star.
Yeah.
Adele is not a traditional looking pop star. Susan Boyle wasn't a traditional looking pop star, and you got the biggest records in the world. And I think that the more that those stupid middle-aged conceptions of what people want to buy can be knocked down, the better for all of us, because we'll all make a hell of a lot more money. Mm. And because it's so annoying, it's so pointless. If you'd have walked all three of those acts into a record company, traditional record company, and said, which one are you going to have, they'd have fallen over themselves to not pick any of them.
Yeah. Mm. Well, Ed Sheeran was famously dropped by Ireland and other record labels.
He was number two on iTunes proper when one record company went in for him. Everybody else passed. Mm. And let's make this really vague so as not to get myself into trouble. One of those acts, I was in the record company in America as they were just blowing up over here, and the head of the record company went, it's never going to work here. 3 months later, there was a picture half the size of the building of that particular person.
Wonder who you could mean. Lucy, I did want to, I mentioned it to some others, but I haven't directly asked you. Are you interested in growing Marillion's audience, or is it a case of solidifying them and keeping them?
Well, no, I mean, we're always interested in growing, but we seem to have sort of managed to stay the same, you know, which is a feat in itself. Sorry, I was going to say fans get older and die, but I didn't mean Marillion. I didn't mean Marillion fans are that old.
Their children inherit the record collection. And
there's lots of dead Beatles fans. Yeah, they seem to be doing all right.
Exactly. So. The average age is sort of, you know, 35 to 50, and they're all having kids now and brainwashing some of their kids, and their kids are coming along. So the older fans who, and people do lose interest. Some people lose interest in music as they get older. Yeah. Some people don't. So the ones we're dropping off, we are replacing. We've stayed the same for like the last 15, well, about 10 years. We've stayed the same. Of course we'd like to grow it. And we're always, you know, Marillion are innovators, as you said, look on Wikipedia, we invented crowdfunding. You know, we're always willing to try anything, to try any of these new things. Try Spotify, try Apple Music, try anything. If someone comes to us with a crazy idea, we'll try it. Because it might just be that thing that gets some people interested. And I think, I've forgotten who said it now, but I think you're right that people, they don't just look at what's the newest. The kids today look at great music.
Yeah.
And they don't care if someone's a 20-year-old pop star or a 50-year-old, you know, musician. They just want something good and interesting. So, yeah, we'll try anything and we'll try to grow for sure.
Final question I'm going to ask it of all of you. We'll start with Martin. What's the we are discussing the future of fan engagement, bringing that relationship between fan and artist closer, monetizing it more effectively. What's the one thing that will improve the monetization and improve the connection between fan and artists over the next 5 to 10 years?
Hit records. In other words, acts that break from their fans, who make more money than anyone else, have more fun, and basically develop close relationships with the people who love them. That's it. That's what you've got to do.
Simple as that.
Yep. And meanwhile, all the others will fade away, because they do.
Dave, one thing that you think could help change the game, could help monetize those fans better, and will do so in the next 5 to 10 years?
Just everybody communicating better. Just everybody stopping being islands, you know, between you know, you do this, we do this, that happens there, that happens there, because that's not how it is anymore.
And I guess the onus to work that puppet falls on you, unfortunately, as the artist representative.
Yeah, but there are really good signs of it. I keep saying this about Ticketmaster, like they're the only people, but she's the only one here that I can say it about. You know, but they are having to work out how to do it now, because there has been a lot of pressure with it. And I see really healthy growth in people trying to communicate and trying to outwardly get that right.
Lucy, one thing that you think is going to improve that relationship between artist and fan and possibly, hopefully, create more revenue per head?
I've been, you know, as I said, without blowing our own trumpets, we've been on the internet a long time, and I've watched artists learning how to communicate with their fans and sat back and gone, oh, that's not how you do it. That's not how you keep those fans loving you. And I think that artists, fans, record companies, whoever's doing it, Ticketmaster, whoever, they've just got to learn the right language and the right way to talk to their fans, and then they will keep their fans on any of the social media.
Bruce, this is going to become deathly predictable, but the one thing that you think will draw artists and fans closer together, I'm not going to ask the question again, I'm just going to say your names after this.
I think you've got to realise that some people, not everybody wants to consume your music through our D2C store, or an artist D2C store platform. Some people will always go to iTunes, they will always go to Amazon, they will always go to the high street, if there's anyone left, God bless them. And accepting that, but from our point of view, representing the artist, we have to work with all those people. We work with Ticketmaster, C-Tickets, Spotify, YouTube. I think the one thing that hasn't really happened yet, which I think is a big opportunity for artists to get their head around in engaging the fans, is an effective, well-priced, well-run subscription model.
And you mean just an artist subscription?
Yeah, I think so, yeah. But that should be established, taking on board all the feedback from all the different sales platforms, and then working with management to drive that forward. Because yes, lots of people will buy a box set for £300, yeah, but there's plenty of people that are happy to spend £20-30.
Yeah.
But if that's put together in a yearly subscribable model, I think that's be very exciting for artists, and they'll make a decent amount of revenue every year.
Fascinating stat. There's been.
It won't be in the charts.
Well, it will be, because we'll sell albums as part of the year subscription, which will be registered for the charts. So, even I just don't want to.
That's how you invoice it.
I just don't. Anyway. I just don't see a pre-order. I don't see our job as just rolling for a couple of months. Mm. I want an album to be promoted for a 12-month period.
There's been a million. It'll be very quick. But one really interesting stat about this whole Adele 25 phenomenon is just the ticket pre-sale. 500,000 people from the UK and Europe registered Adele.com, mm, all their details, just for the chance to get a ticket. And you do have to wonder if you use that as a launch pad for some kind of subscription or reward to those 500,000 people, how many of them, and I bet even if 1% did it, it'd be worth it, would just chuck a couple of quid a month in. Yeah. Rob,
From a label point of view, and we see this all the time, and it's so frustrating, is that artists who can't communicate properly on social media, artists that don't do it in a timely fashion, they put the wrong messages out, they use the wrong links, they don't listen to the experts, they think they know how to communicate with their fans, and it's all about, we just turn up to the gig and play the show. That's a big part of it, but you've got to talk to them after the show, not just at the merch stand, but you've got to talk to them through Instagram and Twitter and Facebook, and they've just got to get better at that whole part of the business. And then I think from a label, we'll see more monetization of our products. That's my point.
Listen to the label.
Just listen to the experts around you. That's why you choose to work with these people, be it a D2C company, be it Dave, you know, be it a ticketing company. You know, we're not here because we've got hobbies. This is what we do every day, and we do it really well.
But Paul, the one big opportunity.
One big opportunity. I think as an industry, we've got an opportunity to work together better, make it easier for the fan, make it better value for the fan. I think ultimately we have to show the fans respect. Just respect them, and they'll stay with you and they'll come back. But I think now is a good opportunity, because there's lots of options, there's lots of data out there, there's lots of people to work with. So I think we have a responsibility to make it easier for the fan because it'll be better for the artists.
Sarah?
For us, it's kind of, it's from a Ticketmaster point of view, it's our data. So we have a lot of data and a whole floor that kind of are working, kind of making that into targeted groups that are so clever, they go over my head sometimes. So for us, it's how do we use that data on behalf of managers, artists, labels, to be able to really target those groups, you know, talking about the premium box set. Well, we know those high ticket spenders, so can we use that to help these guys? You know, of course we want to sell tickets, that's our main job, but, you know, what else can we do along with that as well?
Thank you. That just leaves it up to me to say, has anyone got a question? We might have a minute for one. Yes?
Thanks, Tim. The question is, which has been going up back in my mind for quite a while now, is who is primarily responsible for the social media strategy of a band?
Dave, you manage the Libertines, gigantic act, major label act. Who runs their social media?
Don't tell me it's Pete Doherty.
He does run one part of it. Yeah, he does, yeah. There's on an act like the Libertines, there's several things. There is the word of the band, but the word of the band as by the manager. And we try and separate it up. So we have a kid. We're a kid. He's not a kid at all. He's in his 30s. But we have a guy called Alex who looks after most. He doesn't work in-house with us, but he looks after most of our acts as the word of the band, right? So it's very obvious when it's him posting on any of these things and when it's the artist posting on any of the things. Peter, Carl, Gary and John in the band all actually, and it's easy to forget, they started through social media. You know, their comms message was through MySpace. Their gigs were around through. They're one of the very first bands to take advantage of any of that stuff. And Peter knows better than anybody the power of it. He was putting out messages on his Twitter to get 500 people to a cash-only gig in Brixton, you know, up until about a month ago. You know, so you know, what is inevitable is the younger people want the message as pure from themselves as possible. So Charlie very rarely, if ever, allows anybody, unless it's literally an emergency and she's on a plane, to do anything apart from her. She runs absolutely every side of it and is infuriated if anybody would ever try and get in the way of it. And I find the younger you go down the spectrum, the more they have that opinion.
And where is she present, for example, Charlie? She's on Twitter, I suppose, and what?
She's on Instagram, which I think is her primary. She has 2 million on Instagram. She's got 3 million on Facebook and 2 million on Twitter, I think, now. And so it's like, I think it's kind of, and actually that on a monetization thing, that's the only thing that anybody looks at. You know, that's the weird thing. It's like tweets. We spend more time negotiating over tweets than we do about any other part of the contract. Because keeping that timeline pure is the most important thing for the act.
You mean you negotiate not letting anyone else have the keys to it?
Well, not tweeting. If we did a deal with Jaguar, for example, Jaguar would say they want 7 tweets. And largely their comms departments are useless. And so they want Charlie literally stepping out of a Jaguar. This isn't real, by the way, but just stepping out of a Jaguar and saying, I bloody love Jaguar me on a timeline that's about unicorns and glitter. You know, it's just ridiculous. So most of our life across every bit of our job is arguing with people about what messages go up on social media and what don't.
Keeping the fan message pure. That leaves it to me. We're a little bit over time, so I'm sure everyone would like to have a chat and a drink here, but it leaves it to me to say thank you very much to all of our panellists, Sarah, Paul, Rob, Bruce, Lucy, Dave and Martin. Thank you.
Obsession. We wouldn't talk.
I don't want to change the world. I'm not looking for New England. I'm just looking for another girl.